Creative Barn is dedicated to providing a permanent creative arts incubator and community art space in Arbor Hill, a place for artists to live, work, and inspire. Since opening its doors in April 2014, the barn has welcomed more than 5,000 visitors annually for theatrical productions, concerts, exhibitions, and special events, while artists in residence spend more than 700 hours annually engaging the community in a wide variety of creative arts programming. With more than 16,000 creative freelancers living and working in the Capital Region, the barn has become a resource for developing new projects and programs that employ creatives and restore vibrancy to neighborhoods and business districts around the region.
Hi, my name is Kristen Holler. I'm the Executive Director of Albany Barn and Electric City Barn, and we are standing just inside the front door of the soon-to-open Electric City Barn. We're keeping the space under wraps until we open on October 27th, but I wanted to take some time to share a little bit about our history and our plans for the future in this great new space. So Electric City Barn is an affiliated sort of company or organization to Albany Barn, which was founded in 2006 to provide a hand up to local creatives and artists looking to achieve some sustainability around their career within the creative economy, and then also to facilitate opportunities for those artists and makers to engage with the community through internships, apprenticeships, programming, exhibitions, you name it. So it's really been all about building community and building capacity for our local creative economy. So as I said, we were founded in 2006, and in 2009 we opened our first space in Arbor Hill, a storefront gallery called Stage One, and in April of 2014 we opened the Albany Barn. And so that facility has 22 affordable live-work apartments for emerging artists and about 14,000 square feet of commercial space. So those are work studios, performance venue, and shared co-working and workspace for artists and makers of all different types. So that could be anything from a culinary artist to a traditional fine artist, performance artist, or folks who work in digital media, photography, things of that nature. For our artists in residence, the importance of affordable, quality live-work space and work-only studios was really top of mind as we started to develop our kind of following of artists and to really identify who was in the Capital Region working in this creative space and what their needs were. Affordable live workspace came up over and over again. And so what that means is artists can pay for their live work apartment based on their income and have access to, again, those professional development and technical assistance services that we offer in order to be able to kind of improve their business model, improve their sustainability, and know that they have this cushion of affordable live workspace that's going to fluctuate with their income. So when they see, you know, their income go up, they might pay a little bit more, but if they have, you know, periods where maybe their workload is a little bit lighter or they're developing a new project that will help them to realize an income stream that's deferred a little bit, they have that flexibility of being able to have their rent adjusted to reflect that. So the exchange that we expect is that they're engaged members of the community. And that looks different for everybody, what that is. There are some folks who want to get in front of an audience and teach a class or facilitate a workshop. And then we have folks who are more introverted. That's not really their speed. So they might just produce an exhibition or a performance where they're really more behind the scenes, helping to coordinate and curate and put the plans together and pull the event together, but that at the end of the day, the community has access to this arts or cultural program. So that's a really big part of what we do, and the services are really highly individualized. You know, we don't have cookie cutter programs that we offer to people. It's really about sitting down with that artist or maker and saying, what are your specific goals? what level of income do you need to achieve? What are your sort of philanthropic or altruistic intentions? What are the ways in which you want to engage the community? What are the causes that you care about? And how do we wrap that all into one package where you are sort of living this creative lifestyle where you're sustained, you have your basic needs met, and you're doing things that are both creatively and personally and professionally fulfilling to you. So it's a lot of one-on-one work with our artists in residence. So that's sort of the story of where we came from and how this model evolved. Our space at the Electric City Barn really took that idea of providing affordable working space and those facilitation, professional development, business development services, and being able to offer even more resources to local creatives and makers. So we came up with the idea to do more of a makerspace model. So rather than small, privately leased studios where folks were responsible for bringing in their own equipment and really determining what, if any, programming happens in their space, at the Electric City Barn, we have five distinct lab spaces, all of which are equipped and will support specific discipline areas. So those are a wood shop, a metalworking studio, fiber arts and textiles, electronics, and digital media and 3D printing. So again, the idea here is that a lot of folks have, they have skills, they're creative, they have great project ideas, but they might need a piece of equipment that's outside of their price range, or that isn't something that they can have in their home or in their studio, but it's necessary to kind of grow their business or complete a new project. So we want to invite those folks into the makerspace, and they can do that by becoming a member and doing some basic safety training, and then having individual kind of access to the studio that they need, or they can develop a residency project with us. And what that would entail would be a project that requires some sort of capacity building on the part of the maker. So to use the example of a clothing designer, if I'm a clothing designer and I want to start to wholesale my garments, but I'm producing them all by myself, we would help that maker to determine what pieces of their creative process or their production process that they could actually train people to do. And then build a program around that. So they would have access to a studio that's well equipped, as well as assistance in recruiting some help to produce whatever their product is, in this case, clothing. And we would work with local community organizations that do workforce development or transition services, where they're helping people to get retrained or get into the workforce, and work with those folks to connect them with an entrepreneur or maker to learn these skills that then can lead them down their own path of some sort. It could be that they pick up a new hobby, or it could be that this becomes an entrepreneurial or career pursuit for them as well.
I've tried walking away from art because I'm expecting you're going to ask me, why do I paint, why do I make art? And I don't know. When I went to college, I was a German major. I took a studio art class in the spring of my freshman year. And after the first class, I went and changed my major. Like, this is what I need to be doing. Still took German, French, one of my minors is in languages. And one in history. So, I just realized every time something bad happens, I paint about it. Doesn't change it, but I get a painting out of it, and I can put emotion into it, so you can get some decent, powerful stuff. To various things. And then I start working on a mixed media color. I've got, obviously, probably best to show me. Old. So, found objects, things with texture. This I did 3 days after my dog died. Fuck this.
self-portrait after Presley. So, but yeah, this is what frees me up if I get into like a creative slump. I just collect all these different things and start moving them around. I use gravestone rubbing wax now instead of with crayon. It's the crayon. If I went over one of these black lines with a wet brush, it would actually make a gray wash. So these are, I want to call them dirtier, murkier than I want them to be. But, so yeah, I've been doing this kind of fun thing, I can say, since the late 70s. That's why I have bags and boxes. It's my current work. How can it not? Like I said, I was very heavy on pollution. I canvassed on the Love Canal. I one time actually got to, got to talk to the guy who built the fence around the Love Canal, and he was describing all the colors in the puddles to me. You know, it's like just amazing stuff. So that's why rolling back all these environmental protections is like kind of flipping me out. Yeah, so this may ultimately turn out to be my true art form, but I call them monofrots because they're like a monotype print, except it's frittage. If I created the process, I forget to name it. So, it's life. Nobody gets out unscathed, undinged, undented. Okay. Then we painted like this, and I was calling it A Path Seldom Taken. But then I like it better like this, and so I started working it in this direction, and it reminds me of pinball machines and an arcade. And each orientation, it's something different. That one's not so strong, but like this, pretty strong. So it's a different painting each time, depending on how you orient it. So what I always do is I cut the square out of the rectangle. So I want that showing on each side. So it kind of starts breaking it down into spaces for me. Then I always indicate where the exact center of the canvas is, because I don't want to put anything right there. Maybe an edge, something, but nothing else. And then it's just like intuitive and kind of random. I'm over here and I'm just drawing lines. And it's an exercise in composition at this point. I have nothing specific that I'm trying to express, but it will, as I'm working on it, decide what it wants to be and kind of suggest things and lead me a different direction. And it'll be a different painting depending on how I turn it. I set it up this way, looks kind of portraitish. This way it's something else. So I've heard a good abstract can be viewed from all four sides and be equally valid. I've got my latest painting before this one. I may have to sign on four different sides and put a different title on each one, and I don't know, maybe some kind of a little Lazy Susan thing and just spin it depending on your mood. I think I'll watch it this way, you know, today. So I'll get paintings like that, and every day I'll flip them over a different view and keep looking at it. And so it's tough enough coming up with one name, but I'm going to may have to come up with four. So.
So as I mentioned, one of the spaces that we will have is our wood shop coming soon. And so one of the things when we were thinking about what types of facilities we would have here at the Electric City Barn, we really tried to think about not only disciplines that require specialized equipment or equipment that might be cost prohibitive or space prohibitive, but also to think about what the potential community impact was by providing access to specific skill sets and specific discipline areas. The wood shop came up through talking with a number of different organizations and through our participation in a 2016 public art project called Breathing Lights that highlighted the issue of vacancy and blight within our neighborhoods and the volume of vacant homes specifically within the cities of Albany, Schenectady, and Troy. And so in the process of working on that project and making connections with organizations that were concerned with things like housing and housing safety, historic preservation, and all of these different sort of niche areas that really impact the look and feel of a community and how safe it is and how attractive it would be to folks and what types of opportunities exist there, we started to really uncover that there was a really unique feature of the Capital Region is the historic nature of many of our neighborhoods. And so many of these vacant and abandoned homes are historic. They could be Victorian, and so looking at what the opportunities were for rehabbing these homes and whether or not there was an opportunity to create some training programs that would prepare people to take on the jobs that could be available should folks utilize programs through the land bank, affordable housing, Habitat for Humanity, things like that, to start to reclaim some of these vacant spaces and restore them to their, you know, their former kind of luster. And so the wood shop really supports that because, again, working with our residency model, we could bring in somebody who has some expertise in woodworking to introduce people to the different tools and techniques of that trade, and also provide people with information for how they would go about getting onto that career path of looking into architectural restoration and historic preservation. So again, all about giving people access to tools and to expertise in a certain discipline area to be that starting point that maybe somebody discovers a passion that they didn't know they had or discovers that they have a natural knack for woodworking that they never would have discovered if they hadn't had access to the tools as well as the education, the training, the mentorship, and the encouragement to take a chance and to try something a little bit different.
So to take a break and talk a little bit about how I got here and how the kind of vision for what the barn would become and how we would achieve our mission has evolved. We're upstairs on the second floor in what we're affectionately calling the hayloft of the Electric City Barn. And, when we talk about engaging the community in the makerspace and involving folks in internships, apprenticeships, training programs, it's something that's really near and dear to my heart personally, but also professionally, and sort of how the trajectory of my own career was influenced by the barn. So I actually started with the organization a little over 12 years ago as our founder's intern. So the organization was founded by a gentleman named Jeff Morrell, who continues to serve as the president of the board of Albany Barn. And I was a college student looking for opportunities to give back. And particularly, I had gone away to Northern New York to go to school. And I was in my junior year of college and seeing a lot of my friends sign up for programs like Teach for America, the Peace Corps. My brother moved to the Midwest to pursue a career as a youth minister, and I thought, I feel like if I'm going to give back, I really want to do that in the city that raised me, in the place that I call home. I feel like the place that you come from and where your roots kind of are really define a lot of who you are as a person, and I really feel that way personally. And so I started poking around, and through social media, MySpace actually, the social media of the day, I found this profile called Albany Barn, and I read about this, amazing vision to support artists so that they could live and work affordably and have the freedom of time and finances to be able to bring their work out into the community, to engage people and to make a difference. And that really hit home with me because I'm a product of the Sales School of Fine Arts at Schenectady High School. You know, I was really fortunate to be immersed in all different forms of art growing up, and it really, particularly through my teenage years, made such an impact on, you know, who I was, and my network of friends and the mentors that I had sort of all came from those experiences. So I ended up moving back to the area, working as an intern, serving on our board of directors, and in noticing a need at the board level for some expertise in human resources, I went back to school and finished my degree in human resources development and got a job in a human resources office at a local not-for-profit. And there I really discovered a passion for this training and development piece of the HR function, and thought, you know, not only could this benefit the barn, you know, down the road from an internal staffing perspective, but really using these self-directed career management tools and these personal and professional development tools that I was learning on the job to help artists to really, you know, take hold of their career and to empower them to always be looking at development opportunities and continually improving their skill sets and going after these opportunities for education and mentorship and things of that nature to help them to achieve those career goals. You know, just because they're not traditionally employed, you know, in a 9-to-5 and on somebody's payroll, they still needed those skills, those business skills. And that really got me thinking about how we could really best serve the local arts community. And so for me, this career path that I literally stumbled into, you know, is so valuable to me. I find such meaning in it because it really marries all of these things that I love, which is helping people to identify what they're great at, really being their champion, their cheerleader, but then also helping to connect them to resources so that they can make meaningful and actionable plans to achieve goals. You know, and then also just helping people to find their love for the arts and confidence in their creativity and being able to take chances. So as I said, starting out as an intern and sort of growing in my role with the barn over the years, you know, I've certainly been very fortunate to be able to influence the mission of the organization and how we achieve that mission. You know, and with the opening of Electric City Barn, that's really been my opportunity to evaluate what we have done, the lessons that we learned, looking at the current needs of the folks that we're working with, both on the community side and within the creative community, and say, how do we really serve as a hub? How can we really be a connecting point that brings this all to the next level, that really creates community, creates an ecosystem where people understand the value of arts and culture from, you know, just sort of a quality of life perspective, but then they also understand the importance of arts and culture as an economic engine. You know, Schenectady really kind of had this like gritty post-industrial city feel about it. And I think it's easy to become negative about that. It's easy to say, there's nothing for me here, I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna go somewhere else. And I always just had this real affection for Schenectady, for the capital region as a whole. I consider myself a city gal, but a small city gal, and I just think there's so much opportunity here to really build things. If you have that passion and the vision, I think there's so much support to revive this city. There's so much intention, so much you know, real care behind what happens in this city and what the next kind of identity of Schenectady as the Electric City is. There is still a lot of opportunity for folks to get involved literally from day one. And so one of the things that has become very important as we've developed this model is making sure that there are lots of different ways that people can access this space, and at different levels and for different reasons. And part of that is we really would like to fill out our calendar with a diverse variety of programming that includes performances, so theatrical productions, concerts, fashion shows, things of that nature, as well as workshops and classes,
where people from all different skill levels can come in and do, you know, a very basic beginner project all the way up to really more complex, highly technical skills and projects. So we're looking for artists across all disciplines, makers, instructors, to come in and pitch us your ideas. We really want to develop a class and workshop schedule. We certainly have lots of opportunity for these project-based residency programs, and those can be anything from a public art project or, you know, a small business growth plan to some sort of a community benefit or beautification project that can leverage the tools and facilities of the makers. So once again, I'm Kristen Holler here at Electric City Barn. I'm so excited to welcome everyone into our space October 27th from 2 to 5 p.m. At the Electric City Barn, 400 Craig Street in Schenectady. And until then, I urge everyone to connect with us on social media at Electric City Barn on all social media platforms or through our website, www.electriccitybarn.org.
Well, welcome back. I'm still trying to bake the muffins. But finally, I think we're finished. I hope you enjoyed our show today. If you would like to make an order or donate muffins to charity, then please go to the website listed below. With every muffin order, we donate muffins to the charity of your choice. I call it giving your dough to charity. I also encourage you to donate directly to the featured charity today by going directly to our website and getting their information. Thank you very much for watching, and keep on dancing through life by giving to others through love. Let me finish baking these muffins, and see you next time.